Hey, everypony. Digibrony here with part 5 of my Digi's Crib series. You may be wondering, what the hey happened for the past few days? How come there hasn't been any new videos from this series? Well, right after we did part 4, then we went way out of town to DC to go see a show. And when we came back, then I found out that my videos had been taken down on Digibrony, so I started remaking those. And then it was just a matter of, like, Victor didn't want to keep filming and stuff because he's busy with school. So I was like, I'll just do it by myself. And yeah, so it's just been a busy few days where I didn't get the chance to refilm stuff. Also, we had already filmed this shelf of the collection, but it was really bad. We did it while we were doing part 4 and 3 with Brandon Tolentino. And basically we all got really tired and we just started rushing, and I figured that kind of defeats the point of the series, which is to talk about each item of my collection, so rushing through was not the best choice. So we're going to start over again. Starting with this, Akira on Blu-ray. This is an anime classic, definitely one of the movies that helps to bring anime to the US, actually, in the late 80s, early 90s area. It's a fantastic series. I have the first volume of the manga as well, which, the manga is a classic everyone should read. The movie is also a classic, but what's interesting about it is that, the guy who wrote the manga made the movie, and so it's really shortened down, but it's like at least the guy who made it chose what to shorten down, you know? It's interesting to watch if you've already read the manga, but yeah. Both are classics and definitely worth seeing. Oh, and this is one of the most beautifully animated movies of all time as well. Next we have 3x3 Eyes. This is a short, I believe it's just, is it two discs or something? I don't know, I've got a flip cover on. No, it's just the first 4 episodes. There was 2 OVAs of 3x3 Eyes. One that's 4 episodes, one that's 3 episodes. I think I've only even seen this one. I probably bought it because it was probably cheap and I was at FYE and probably had some extra money or something. I was just trying to buy OVAs because you don't have to buy multiple volumes of OVAs. This makes them great. This series was based on a manga that was really popular in the, I want to say, early 90s. I think it's, if you're into stuff like Inuyasha, this will totally appeal to you. It's definitely from that vein. It's a bit darker, probably, than Inuyasha is, but, it's from that era, and it's got that kind of style. The same kind of characters are in it. It's pretty good. The manga would be way longer than the anime series. They only made a couple OVAs of it, but still interesting. Here, the first volume of Air. As I mentioned, I bought this, and then my friend gave me the box set, so that's why I have 2 copies of it. Next, we have Arjuna. This is a great show. This is the full 4 DVDs of Arjuna. This show is interesting because it's kind of preachy. It's really about, like, being environmentally conscious and stuff like that, but in, like, the most epic and fantastical fashion. It's a lot like a Hayao Miyazaki movie or something, but in an anime series. And whereas Miyazaki movies usually are more about the story and adventure, this one's really about the concepts that it's talking about. But, it's basically about this girl who dies and then she reawakens as like a magical girl of sorts, but she has the power to communicate with nature and stuff, and it's really just cool. And it's got an amazing soundtrack by Yoko Kanno, who is one of the most famous anime composers. She did the Cowboy Bebop soundtrack and some other great ones. This show, the soundtrack is so fantastic that there's an option on these DVDs to watch the show with just the soundtrack, with no dialogue, and I think that's super cool. I've not actually done it though. Assemble Insert. This is a random OVA from the, I believe, 1989 or something. A lot of people like this. I didn't really care for it. I just bought it because it was like $2. Another OVA, Battle Angel Alita. This is based on a long-running sci-fi, I guess cyberpunk series, manga series. They only made 2 episodes of anime out of it, and they're kind of from the age where anime OVA, because in the late 80s, anime OVAs were, like, usually really high budget and really awesome. And then moving into the early 90s, it was, like, the Japanese economic bubble burst or something like that, and anime OVAs got a lot less budgeted. This was kind of in the middle there, where it's, like, like, one episode looks really nice, but the other one's kind of eh, and it's like, this probably would have done a lot better if it had not been right at that time. But yeah, it's pretty decent OVA, and the manga's really cool, so that's worth checking out. It's been running forever. Here we have almost all of Brigadoon. If you can see, it says 1, 2, 4, 5, 6. And the reason for that is that I actually have two volume 6s. Because I bought it at Otakon 1 year, and it was a pack of 6. And I didn't notice until I got it home that it had two volume 6s in it and no volume 3. So, yeah, that's a pain in the ass. I've never actually finished this series, but it's pretty cool. It's a really bizarre sort of, it's one of those shows that goes from, like, spastic comedy to serious drama, like, at the drop of a hat. It's about this little girl who's, like, hilarious, and she's just, like, a constant spastic monster, and she finds this giant robot and becomes friends with it and stuff. It's weird and out there, but, I never did finish this. Not just because I don't have Volume 3, I downloaded the show afterwards, but, anyway, Kanon on Blu-ray. This is the full Kanon set, which is just on, like, two discs in one box. This was the last anime DVD or Blu-ray that I bought. It was in Christmas about almost 3 years ago, I want to say, is when I got this. Yeah. So, the thing is that this show was released by Sentai Filmworks, which is what ADV became, and it says on the back, it's like, oh, 1080p high definition, but if you ask someone who knows, this show did not air in 1080p, it was not made in 1080p. So this DVDs, or these Blu-rays, is most likely 1080i, most likely just not amazing quality, because the thing is that all the American companies that were releasing Blu-rays for a while were doing a poor job of it. Like, they would come out and they'd be lower quality than what you could have downloaded online for free with fan subs, you know? And you could have downloaded fan subs that are probably more accurate than whatever subs are on these DVDs anyway. So, yeah, I don't like the way the anime industry went, or is going, or has gone. I don't know. I don't even know if the anime industry is still, like, is it still dying? Is it doing decently now? Have they finally done well with streams? I have been out of the loop for a little while, but this is about where I left off, was Kanon. Cat Soup, I've not actually watched this yet, but I've heard it's a complete trip. My aunt sent it to me with all her anime stuff that she didn't want anymore. So, yeah, it's like a 45-minute OVA, I think, that's just, like, weird, trippy stuff. Dokoida! This is an anime series that's meant to be a parody of, Super Sentai, well, not Super Sentai, but more like Kamen Rider. It's basically a Kamen Rider parody. It's about this guy who, he kind of is poor, and he just lives in, like, this shitty apartment, and he gets an offer from this alien girl, where she's like, we need you to become a superhero to advertise toys of that superhero. So he is, like, a living toy advertisement, and he fights all these villains, and it, like, all the villains live in the same apartment complex as him, but none of them know that they are each other's alter egos. So they all just, like, kind of hang out and are friends, in regular life, and then, you know, they're all fighting. And it's, you know, just like a fun comedy show. Eva 2.22, You Cannot Advance. This is the second of the Evangelion remake movies, which are, you know, still coming out. The third one just came out, and I've heard that it's strange and awful. Basically, every person who's written about it has been like, this is really bad, but in a kind of interesting way. I don't know. I've heard it's bad, though. I haven't seen it yet, though. But I do have 2.22. It's a great film. I don't have part one, oddly enough. This is the first two DVDs of Figure 17. This is another really weird show. This show is known for, it's 13 episodes long, but the episodes are 45 minutes long apiece, and they are just really slow and dry, so it's hard to watch. I have not actually even gotten to the second volume of these DVDs before, because the show is so slow, but it's really interesting and cool. It's about this little girl who moves out to the countryside, and she's really shy, and no one really likes her, but then she manages to, like, stumble upon this alien technology or whatever, and then, like, accidentally clones herself. And so there's, like, two of her running around, and I think they, like, fuse into this lady who fights crime, and it's got awesome music. I don't know, it's confusing. Again, I never finished it, so I've heard it gets really dark, though. Here's the first season of Hidamari Sketch. I was a really big fan of this show for a long time. I've still never watched season 3, oddly enough, but this is season 1 with the two OVAs of season 1. It's awesome. This is just like four girls just sitting around kind of show. It's just slice of life, you know. It's about friends being friends with one another. I used to always say that one day I would find the perfect woman, and it would be a woman who I could just sit on the, like, lay under a blanket and watch Hidamari sketch with. That's my romantic fantasy right there, is to watch Hidamari sketch with a girl. Anyway, first volume of Higurashi. I actually have the box set of this. I had bought this, like, really early on to it coming out in the U.S., and but I do have the season 1 box. Higurashi is a great show, extremely dark and violent. I think most of you have probably, or those of you who are anime fans have probably heard of it before. Idol Project is another just random 90s OVA that I bought on a whim because it was $2. And it's just weird and not very good, so I don't even think I finished it. I have like two episodes on here, and I think I watched the first one, and I was like, this is dumb. Irresponsible Captain Tyler. I only ever bought volume 1 of this, and that's all I've seen. But it's considered a classic by many. It's an early 90s show that's just like a sort of sci-fi fun show. It's about this guy who just is really irresponsible and dumb, and he stumbles into being the captain of a pilot ship, and it's basically about his ridiculous dumb luck in all kinds of situations. If you like something like Great Teacher Onizuka, this is like that era, that kind of characters. Dark Side Blues. I've not actually watched this. My friend gave it to me because he really didn't like it. Him and Victor watched it and they said it was awful, but I was like, I'll give it a shot, because whatever, I have nothing better to do with my life. Let's move down a rung then. Let's move the camera with us, why not? Come on. Alright, we're on shelf 2, so we have Key the Metal Idol, volume 1. This one, I believe I wanted to buy volumes 2 and 3, but they're just really hard to come by. But this is like a really, really weird OVA from the 90s, again, but it's actually like a 15-episode OVA, so it's like a full show, basically, just released in a weird format. This one's like, it's almost like an anime Pinocchio. It's like this guy invents this this girl, and she's a robot, and she really has no emotions and stuff, but she ends up becoming an idol singer. From what I remember, this show was just so bizarre, it was hard to even get a grip on what it was about. It was just like, oh, this is okay. Here's Last Exile Volume 1. I talked about having the box that doesn't have the last volume in it earlier. I bought this because it came with the soundtrack, and I believe I bought this when Genion was going out of business, so all their DVDs were and CDs were super cheap, which I'll talk more about in a bit. The Lucky Star OVA. Kind of think of it, I should have the Lucky Star box with Volume 1, but it wasn't up here for some reason, but that was given to me by Dansan when he gave me all his anime DVDs, but this one I bought individually, the OVA, because it's the best episode of Lucky Star, and it's just a lot of fun, and it has Kagemiku, who, as you know, I have a Figma of over in the other section of my collection. Moving along, Madlax, Volumes 1 and 4. This show is god-awful, and the reason I own it is that I run a blog called I Hate B-Train, and it's literally a whole site dedicated to me just really hating the animation studio B-Train, because they're really bad. So, Madlax was the first show that I started talking about on there, and I never did finish blogging it, but I got 14 episodes in, and I was having so much fun ripping on this show. Well, I was at a local video store one day, and they had volume 4 for $1. And that's the volume I was on in blogging the show, so I was like, I gotta buy that. So I bought volume 4, and then they also later had volume 1 for $1, and I went, yeah? I'd love to have, I mean, Madlax, to buy the whole show and just own it, is worth $6 if I can keep buying them for $1 a piece, because, you know, the ironic enjoyment there is so high. Here we have the first volume of Magic Knight Rayearth. I know JBC Blank is definitely watching my videos, so she'll enjoy seeing this because she said that she's seen it before, I believe, like in the 90s. This is another 90s show that's considered a classic by a lot of people. It actually, I believe this aired in a lot of different countries too, so if you're around the world, you might have this as a childhood memory. It's one of the earliest series by the manga group Clamp, who are best known for they did Tsubasa Reservoir Chronicle and X and XXXHolic, and What are they best known for? They did the character designs for Code Geass, Clamp. Come now. Everything Clamp does is super popular, so you've probably seen something by Clamp before. I can't think of what their most famous thing is. Anyway, Ray Earth. The thing about the show, I watched this first DVD, and that's about all I've seen of the actual show. And then I found out that there's a Dreamcast game that's a Saturn game that's an action RPG. And I've played about 2 hours of it, and it, like, has the entire show in it, practically. Like, all the dialogue from the show, they go through in the game. And it has, like, scenes from the show, like, for cutscenes and stuff. And it's really awesome, so I'm hoping to, like, just play the game, and then, like, I'll get the whole story out of that. That would be interesting. Now we have, like, the first episode of Maze. This is some kind of thing where it's an anime test drive, some kind of 90s thing done by some company. Who is it? Oh, God. I'm sure they're not around anymore. Central Park Media. Yeah, they've been gone for a long time. So, Maze... Episode 1, it's all I've seen of this show, and it's another bizarre 90s show. It's, like, got gender bending and mechs and comedy, so it's like if you superfuse everything that was popular in the 90s into one show, you'd get Maze. It seemed pretty cool from what little I've seen, but as far as I've gotten. Princess Mononoke. I have a Japanese copy because apparently there's subtitles in the Japanese version, but it's Region 2, so I've never been able to watch it. Princess Mononoke is a classic. Obviously, it's a Hayao Miyazaki and Studio Ghibli film, which all of those are considered, you know, classics. This is the only one I actually own, though, oddly enough. Nadia, Secret of the Blue Water, Volume 1. I've actually watched this whole show. This is what the guy who did Evangelion did right before Evangelion in the studio, Gainax. This show, it's an anime adaptation of 10,000 Leagues Under the Sea, I believe is what it's called, and it's... It starts off pretty good, and it's pretty good for a lot of the run, but then, like, I'm gonna say 3/4 of the way in or so, it just turns to complete shit. Like, there's a whole arc that is awful, and it killed my enjoyment of the series so much that by the end, I was just like, I didn't enjoy that at all, you know? So, it's definitely disappointing. Nana 7 of 7, I think I only watched the first episode of this. I bought it because it was cheap, and it's from the same director as Giant Robo and G Gundam. Oddly enough, even though it's like a cutesy girl show, the guy is best known for doing mech shows. And I haven't really watched it, so I can't say much about it. Perfect Blue, here's another classic anime film. This one's by Satoshi Kon, who sadly passed away about 3 or 4 years ago. He had done Millennium Actress, which I actually have as well, but it's with Brandon Tolentino. He did the TV show Paranoia Agent. He did Tokyo Godfathers, Paprika, and probably his best known film was his original, Perfect Blue. This was described by whoever's on the back of the box as if Disney did a Hitchcock movie, and I totally get that in a way, but it's definitely... It's an interesting psychological horror movie. It's kind of messy, but in a good way, and it's just a blast to watch. And it's totally mind-fucking. So, next we have Les Portraits des Petites French. So, this one is a 3-episode OVA that's by my favorite director, Akiyuki Shinbo. And what's great about this is that basically it's like Shinbo just... going ballistic and doing whatever he wants, because Shinbo is known for doing really stylistic shows, and he has definitely a lot of different styles, but one of those is the dark gothy style, which he was especially doing in the early 2000s. He did the show The Soul Taker, which is extremely dark and gothy, and this is the epitome of that. They literally set out with this show to make a gothic Lolita anime, and that's exactly what they accomplished. To the extent that when I was watching the show, before I knew that they went out to do that, I was like, this seems like they just wrote down the words Gothic and Lolita and decided to make that into a show, and I was right. So yeah, that's what it is. It's great. Total stylish excess. The Place Promised in Our Early Days. This was stolen from Blockbuster, I believe, on accident. It's by, what's his name? The guy who did Voices of a Distant Star and 5 Centimeters Per Second, which are both better and more famous movies. This one kind of sucks, in my opinion. Some people love it still. I don't really care for it. It's just kind of there. Volume 1 of Razaphon. This is an excellent show. The first show by Studio Bones, who would go on to do Eureka 7 and Soul Eater, which I know a lot of you have seen, and a lot of other shows. Uran High School Host Club, same studio. But this is Razaphon, which a lot of people compare to Evangelion, because people used to say, oh, Razaphon's just a ripoff of Eva. But the truth is that most of the people who worked on Razaphon also worked on Eva, so there's a good reason that they would be similar. But, yeah, it's a really cool mech show. Volume 1 of Revolutionary Girl Utena. If you had to ask me what is the greatest anime ever made, and I just offhand came up with something, I'm gonna say Revolutionary Girl Utena every time, because it is that show. Everyone who's seen this will pretty much agree that it is some top-notch, meaningful art shit. So, if you ever want to watch some anime that you're like, what is the most, I don't know, the Ulysses or something. What's a... Give me a book that everyone considers high art, and this is that thing. 39 episodes. I only have the first DVD, oddly enough. I need to get the rest of this show because it's a classic. So go check that out. It's weird and cool and interesting, and if I ever do anime videos, I should probably cover it. I mean, because I've covered it on my blog, obviously, but not enough. Read or Die. This is a fun little OVA that if you've been watching Adult Swim for long enough, you've probably seen before. It's about this girl who can manipulate paper, and she gets into all these big epic fights with these other cool dudes and stuff. It's really a big snazzy battle, crazy epic, you know, kind of OVA. Three episodes of constant high intensity animation. And then they made a TV show out of it called Read or Die the TV. I have the first 6 of 7 volumes, because volume 7 came with a box, and I wanted to get that with the box so I could put all these in it, and I never did. The reason that these all have no covers is that they all had posters, they all had flip cover posters, and so I used to have those up on my wall, and I never got them back into their cases, but this is most of Read or Die the TV show. It's a pretty good show, it's not nearly as good as the OVA, but it has lots of Yuri subplots, and that's, you know, I'm into that, so... Next we have Rurouni Kenshin Volume 7, actually. This was the first DVD I ever bought. I was a big Rurouni Kenshin fan back when it was on TV in like 2004. And I really wanted the fight with Kenshin Himura versus Saito. So I bought that. It's just that DVD. It's like the start of the Kyoto arc where he first fights Saito. And it's like, it was just the coolest fight in the show to me, and I got to see it uncensored, because it's like bloody as shit in this version, whereas on TV, you know, obviously it had no blood, because it was on Cartoon Network, so that was cool. Next we have Rurouni Kenshin Tsuyokuhen and Sei Shouhen, also known as Samurai X, Trust and Betrayal, and Reflections. Samurai X Trust and Betrayal is an absolute classic. It's a 4-episode samurai masterpiece that is definitely worth a look. If you like extreme violence and also beautiful romance, this is the OVA for you. And then you've got the Sei Shouhen, which was the sequel to Rurouni Kenshin. This is a 2-episode sequel that they made to just like sort of wrap up the series. Not a lot of people were happy with this, but I have it anyway. Anyway, moving along. Escryed Volumes 1 and 2. I never got the full series because my cousin Boyd... back in 2004, when I started, like, getting into anime big time, my cousin Boyd always had $30 he would get every week, and, like, for allowance, and we would go to Suncoast, and he would buy anime DVDs, and so I couldn't really do that, because I didn't have any money, I was, like, 13. So, at one point, he had bought a ton of DVDs, mostly Volume 1 and Volume 2s of shows, because he couldn't, like, afford to buy a whole show, and we would always have new interests. So he sold me a bunch of his DVDs at some point, and he sold me the first 2 volumes of Escryed. He later went on to buy the whole show, and I've seen the whole show, and it's a great show, and if you've watched Adult Swim, you might have seen this, which would have been years after I had actually seen it, but, yeah, it's a pretty cool show. It's lots of just hot-blooded yelling and action and, fun stuff. So, we're now going to skip this shelf for now and move down a shelf to the rest of the DVDs. Alright, moving along, we have 2 volumes of Serial Experiments Lane. I'm not sure where the other 2 volumes are, but here's 2 of them. This show I recently loaned out to Brandon Tolentino, so that could be why there's 2 missing. But Serial Experiments Lane is a classic from the 90s. It is a uber psychological and heady show. It's very difficult to understand. Back in the day, people used to always say it took them 4 watches before they fully grasped Lane. And I've been doing episodic, or I was, like, 2 years ago, doing episodic posts on this show back on my blog. And, I was having a lot of fun with that, but I only did the first 6 episodes. So at some point, I really need to finish blogging Lane, because it's a classic. First volume of Shingu, which I never actually watched, so it's just kind of there. The 5 DVDs of Simone. This is the whole show. This is an awesome, like, steampunk Yuri show. It's a, if you really want to see, like, a really unique world in anime and, like, lots of world building for a really unique world, Simone is the way to go. It takes place in a world where everyone starts off as women, and when they turn 18, they go into this, like, this reflective pool thing, and they choose a gender to become. And so, basically, its story revolves around these, like, this group of girls who are all around that age, and they all have to fight in a war, because only pure maidens can pilot the ships that they use to fight in the war. Once you go to the Springs, you can't fight anymore. So basically, each of them is mostly fighting because they don't want to make a decision about life. If that sounds like it leads to all kinds of amazing metaphors and stuff and engaging plot lines, then you are right, if you're into that kind of show. Someone like Brony Curious would fucking eat this show up. So, yeah. That's an excellent show. Strawberry Marshmallow, also known as Ichigo Marshmallow. This is the first DVD, which I believe Donsan gave me, and I never managed to get the rest, but I do love this show. It's just, like, cute girls doing cute things. I think that's actually the motto of the show. This one's Cute Is As Cute Does is the name of this DVD. So yeah, that's basically all it's about. First volume of The Soul Taker. I never actually bought the rest of this, but I have seen it. This, again, is by Akiyuki Shinbo, and it is dark and gritty, and it's just basically stylistic excess, which I enjoy. Slayer's Excellent. I think this is a Slayer's movie. I've never actually watched any of Slayer's. My aunt sent me this, and I have not watched it yet. The first season of Spice and Wolf. This was actually... probably bought this before they had even made a second season of Spice and Wolf, but this was a fun show. Everyone calls it Moe Economics because it's about, like, half of it is slice of life with this cute fox girl, and the other half is, like, really intense economics and stuff. It also has some intense drama in it as well, but I have not actually watched this since 2008, so I can't remember too much about it. First volume of Steam Detectives I bought because it looked cool and it was cheap, and I've still never watched that at all, so I have no opinion on that. Tenemonia Voyagers. This is a 4-episode OVA from the 90s, once again directed by Akiyuki Shinbo, which is why I bought it, and it's really cool. It had, like, the 4th episode was spectacular, for instance. It was just, like, a lot of fun, but there was only 4 episodes made. They had intended for it to be longer. Like, when you watch it, you can clearly tell the story did not come to an end, but it just never happened. Here's all of Technolies. This is a brilliant show, which I recently loaned to Brandon Tolentino, and it was like the first anime that he ever really got into. Still the only anime he's really gotten into, but this is a fantastic show. It's from the same writer as Serial Experiments Lane, Big O, Digimon Tamers, so he's done a lot of stuff, and this is his most intense and difficult to watch show. In fact, this show is physically difficult to watch. It starts off with the main character getting his arm and leg cut off in the first episode, and for the next, like, 2 or 3 episodes, all that guy does is just, like, crawl through town with one leg and one arm, just, like, dying in the streets until someone picks him up, and it's just, the whole show is like that. It's all just dark. I think it cut off when I was saying that this was dark, gritty, violent, disturbing, whatever. Anyway, moving along. First 2 volumes of Tweeny Witches. This is a really exciting, experimental, gorgeous show with short episodes, but with a high intensity of things happening. I have not actually... I don't think I watched volume 2 of this yet. The people who have seen this all really enjoyed it. It's by Studio 4C, who everything they do is known for being really out there. This is probably their most accessible show, but still definitely pretty out there. If you've ever seen... This, if you watched Little Witch Academia, this is the same kind of story and same kind of show, but if it was made by Tim Burton. So it's got that Burton-esque sort of look to everything, very highly detailed art and animation that's constantly whizzing by. So, yeah, it's kind of difficult to watch almost because it's so intense with things happening, but if you like gorgeous animation and unique animation, that's definitely worth a shot. Twilight of the Dark Master, I have not actually watched this yet. It's another Akiyuki Shinbo OVA from the 90s, which is why I have it, and I still haven't watched it yet. I've heard it's pretty okay. I'm obviously missing some DVDs because these shelves should be completely packed. I know I've given a lot of stuff to Brandon Tolentino that he still hasn't watched, like The Skycrawlers, which is one of my favorite movies. I don't even know what else. He's got Nia Under 7, which is also by Yoshitoshi Abe, who did Seal Experiments Lane and Technolies and Hi Bunny Renmei. So a few things like that. He's still got a lot of my DVDs in limbo. Now we're going to move down here. This is all DVDs that were given to me either by Don-san or by my aunt, which I have not yet organized, or watched most of. So, like, Super Milk Chan, two volumes of that. I remember this show from Adult Swim, and it was, like, weird as hell comedy show. I do want to watch this, but I have not yet. Then we have Bottle Fairy, volumes 1 and 2. This is just, like, this super adorable show about these little fairies, and I remember reading a review once where someone said, you should buy this if you're a babysitter, so you can put it on for, like, little kids to watch, because it's just adorable nonsense. The first half, Kanagi, which I did not watch. I watched, like, the first episode of this way back when it aired, and I didn't really get into it. Full Metal Panic Fumofu. This is a classic comedy series that was set in the Full Metal Panic universe using the same characters, but it's just a spastic comedy that really has nothing to do with the actual plot of Full Metal Panic. It's hilarious and a lot of fun. When it came out, I know a lot of people were angry about it because they wanted a new season of Full Metal Panic, and this came out instead. But after this, they made season 2, and then nothing else, so fans have still been mad for all time that there's not more Full Metal Panic. Panda Z, the Robonimation, I've not watched this at all yet. My aunt had it as well. As far as I know, it's a parody of Mazinger Z using pandas, so that sounds interesting. My other Brigadoon Volume 6, which I did not even bother unwrapping. Volume 4 of Nia Under 7, which I have two copies of for some reason. I don't remember why. I think I accidentally bought two copies. The rest of Super Milk Chan is here. This is all of Now and Then, Here and There, which my friend Don-san gave me. This is just dark, hard to watch, just dramatic, just depressing show. It's about these two, like, this kid gets teleported to this world where, like, kids are slaves and soldiers and stuff, and it's just brutal and hard to watch. As dark as a show can get, this one. I watched the first three episodes of this back in, like, 2008, and I remember that the end of episode 3 shocked me so much because I just wasn't ready for it that I just, like, had to leave the house and, like, sulk for a day and just be like, oh my god, I can't believe I just saw that shit. So anyway, moving along. All of Trigun Remix. Dropped like half of it. Trigun is awesome. If you've been an Adult Swim fan for a long time, you've probably seen it. It's kind of a classic from the 90s. Very great show. It was actually my favorite anime for a while. Like 2005 or so, when I really wasn't watching as much anime, but like Trigun stood out in my memory as the one I liked the most. And a second season of Full Metal Panic. I don't even have the first season, but I do have season 2, thanks to Don-san. I still haven't watched this. I watched the first season some time ago and did not watch the second one. I've heard it's even better than the first. I watched, like, the first episode. It was really intense and awesome, but I never did finish Full Metal Panic. So, maybe one day I will. Maybe one day. But, you know, I say that about a lot of shows, and those DVDs are still sitting on my shelf, being pushed back by an endless stream of My Little Pony that will never seem to end since you guys are perpetuating it as much as possible. So, we also have this manga, 60 Years of Japanese Comics. My uncle bought this for me when I was like 11, and at the time I did not read. So I did not really read this thing, even though it does look interesting. I have been meaning to go and read it because it would teach me the history of manga, which I don't know that well, because I know anime history super well, but I don't know the in and outs of manga history. Interestingly enough, there is a section in here about adult comics and, like, you know, like, pornographic comics and stuff, and of course that section as a kid mystified me, because I had never, like, seen that before. I was just like, oh my god, there's boobies. So, yeah, I guess there was some use for this. Just hilarious. So, that covers all of my singles DVDs. As I mentioned, some are missing, but now we're going to get into this, which is my album collection. Mind you, this is specifically everything but my favorite albums, because I recently made a list of my top 50 favorite albums, and all the ones that I own from that list, I put on a different shelf, and I'm trying to collect all of my top 50 favorite albums, because there's a lot of them I don't own. Some of them are impossible to own, but, so this is all that's left of that. So, these are varying degrees of want, basically. Actually, the first CD I ever bought comes up first. Oh, these are in no order, because when we filmed this before, I just kind of shoved them all back in there. But, the Rurouni Kenshin Best Themes Collection. What's funny about this is that it's a Japanese CD, and I had only ever seen the show in English, and it had... The American version of this show has Heart of Sword for the ending theme, and it had Sobakasu for the opening theme, but it never featured any of the other theme songs, so I didn't even know about them until I heard this album, but they're all pretty good. It also has two... The last two songs are both 8-minute power metal songs by the band Anti-Metal, and those totally made the whole album worth it for me as a kid. So, yeah, that's fantastic. The Utena soundtrack as well. There's actually a few Utena soundtracks. Some of them have background music and stuff like that, but this one is specifically the songs written by J.A. Caesar. J.A. Caesar being a composer in Japan who is best known for doing, like, shitloads of plays and all kinds of other avant-garde movies and stuff in Japan, like, shit no one's heard of. But, he also did Revolutionary Girl Utena, because the director brought him on board for it. And he wrote these songs for the... He wrote the songs for the fight scenes. Like, every time there's a fight, there'd be this weird-ass song. He invented a genre in the process of making these songs called choral rock, because all of this... The vocals were done by a chorus, but they were rock songs. It sounds weird, and it is weird. And this album took all the choral rock songs and sort of remixes and remasters them in a more J.A. Caesar style, because in the show they're kind of bare-bones, sort of garage rock sounding. This brings a lot more atmosphere and epicness to them, so it's like just an alternate version. Here we have two albums by Red Sparrows, which is a band that is an offshoot of the band Isis, which they are a classic... They basically invented the genre post-metal. They took post-rock and metalized it, basically. And this is actually them doing regular post-rock. But what's interesting about this band is that they use all brass pedals, and I still don't entirely know what that means, but I know what it sounds like. So they're a brass pedal band. They did their first album, At the Soundless Dawn, which is the better one, and then they have Every Red Heart Shines Towards the Red Sun. I think there were more Red Sparrows albums, but these two are okay. I was never that into them, so I never bought more. Then we have Arion's The Human Experiment. This is a fantastic CD that actually probably could have been in my top 50. It's like on the outskirts. What's interesting about Arion is that it's a progressive rock band, but it's just one guy who does all the music, and there's like a shitload of instruments and stuff, but he does all the music. But there's like 12 vocalists. They're all listed here. He basically would get vocalists from every prog rock band that he could think of and have them play characters in these sort of operatic songs that he writes. So this one's about like a guy who goes into a coma and he's communicating with all of his emotions, like literal personifications of his emotions played by different actors, and all trying to figure out why he's in a coma, what happened before he went into the coma. It has Michael Achterfeldt from Opeth sings on this, which is how I found out about it, probably. It's also got the guy from Dream Theater and a bunch of other famous prog rock singers, so that's pretty cool. The Sound of Animals Fighting, this is their first album, The Tiger and the Duke, remastered with a shitload of remix songs on it. They play experimental... what would you call it? I guess it's sort of like experimental post-hardcore... This album definitely has post-hardcore elements, but it's really out there, so I don't really know what to call it. I guess avant-garde or something. It's very cool. Insomniphobia. This is the latest album from the band Psy. They are a Japanese avant-garde black metal band. And originally, they were more like straight-up black metal from like the early 90s. And then they just kept adding weirder and weirder shit into their albums. This band will go from a like upbeat power metal riff with someone doing dark black metal screams about insanity on it. And then all of a sudden, it will just take off into a jazz piece, like a metal jazz piece, and then a full symphony. And all that will happen in like 3 minutes, and you'll just be like, what the fuck am I listening to? That is Psy. They are just intense, crazy stuff happening at all times. Most of their lyrics are about insanity, so, you know, it really reflects the lyrics. Queens of the Stone Age, Era Vulgaris, you know, from 2006. I was a fan of this album. I've kind of burned out on it over the years, not as big into it as I used to be, but it is definitely a pretty cool CD. And they've actually got a new album coming out finally, the first one since this. So it's been like 7 years, and they're finally about to come out with a new album. The Tenacious D self-titled. This, of course, I'm sure many of you have heard. It's classic comedy rock, folk, acoustic guitar. Just two fat guys singing about being, you know, perverted fat guys, and it's a lot of fun. It's got songs like, "With karate I'll kick your ass, from here to Tiananmen Square. Oh yeah, motherfucker, I'm gonna kick your fucking derriere, yeah, yeah." So, me and my brothers were really into this growing, like, as a, not growing up, but as, like, teenagers. Inciferum's self-titled album. This is a fantastic power, it's really sort of, like, melodic death metal, I guess, but I consider it power metal because it's all really upbeat, fun songs. Inciferum, their first album is fantastic, and each album after that is generally shittier than the last. Like, each of them, it quickly goes from, like, great, and then their second album's pretty good, and then they lost their singer, and the third album was like, eh, and their fourth album's like, eh, and their fifth album's like, eh. So, they went down the shitter, but their first album is still, like, a classic to me. Pale Folklore by Agalloch, this was their first album. I believe all the other Agalloch albums that I own are in the top 50 collection. Their first one is still good. It's just a lot lower production quality. They weren't quite as amazing of songwriters back then, but it's still a great album. By the way, it is, what would I call this? Because Agalloch has never been really classifiable into a genre, but they definitely have elements of black metal, doom metal, folk, definitely lots of folk, neo-folk, that kind of stuff, atmospheric. Everyone should listen to Agalloch, though, because it's just, like, it's really sort of like a transcendental musical experience, where the genre really doesn't matter, it's about the atmosphere. Here we have Amon Amarth, Twilight of the Thunder God. This is, they're pretty much considered melodic death metal. I think they basically invented that genre, or at least they're the most pronounced figure in that genre. This is a pretty good album. I don't really listen to much Amon Amarth because their style just, it really is a mood thing, and I'm rarely in that mood, and I only like some of their songs, but it's a pretty decent album anyway. The first Deer Hunter, there's two bands called Deer Hunter. One of them is D-E-E-R Hunter, all one word, and then there's The Deer Hunter, which is D-E-A-R, because it's a pun, and the guy who leads this band loves puns. So this is the first The Deer Hunter album. Who I'm a big fan of this band. This is kind of an EP, I guess. It's just a really short album or whatever, and it's definitely got some interesting songs on it. It definitely feels like a first album by a band who would go on to do much bigger things on their second and third album, which are both in my top 50 collection, but it is still a fantastic release. So, next up we have Blind Guardian's Night at the Opera. This is power metal to the most epic degree. The technique that this band used on this album, they used shitloads of tracks. So it sounded like they wanted to have like 5 guitar tracks, 5 drum tracks, 5 vocal tracks, because they wanted it to sound like an army of musicians. So they definitely achieved that effect. This is one of my favorite songs on it, which is called "And Then There Was Silence," and it's a 14-minute power metal retelling of the Iliad, and that's fucking badass. So yeah, that's a cool album. Arion's The Universal Migrator. This one is kind of boring, and I've never been really into it, but it's a 2-disc CD where it's like a, it's a sci-fi album about a guy who's basically gets into this machine. He's like the last human, I believe, and he's on Mars, and he gets into a machine that takes him through all of history, first human history, and then the history of the universe in like the 2 different parts of the album. It's pretty interesting, but it's just like kind of, it's prog in a way that I'm not really that into. If you're a big prog fan, you'd probably enjoy this album. Tool's Lateralis album. This is sort of a classic, especially for me. It has, like, Lateralis on it, which is a classic song, Parabola, Schism. So a lot of the most famous Tool songs are on here, and it's pretty awesome. Not my favorite Tool album anymore, but it was at a time, and it's pretty cool. At the Drive-In's, this station is non-operational. This is a collection album, like just a shitload of songs from all of their CDs. I was a big fan of the Mars Volta, especially in the mid-2000s, and I didn't really get into At the Drive-In, so I got this just so I would like get a gist of what they were about. And only more recently did I start actually listening to some of their music, like, more regularly, but yeah. The Arjuna soundtrack, as I mentioned when talking about the DVD, this is phenomenal, by Yoko Kanno. The FLCL soundtrack, this is the third soundtrack, which is the one that has all, it's literally just songs by The Pillows, because there are two other soundtracks, and despite what many people think from watching FLCL, there are songs not by The Pillows in the show. But this is all The Pillows songs on there, so yeah, it's got a ton of classics. And the battery's dying, so I'm going to cut the clip here. And we're back. An hour has passed for me, but no time has passed for you. The Fall of Troy, Doppelganger. This was, I believe, the first full release by The Fall of Troy. It's actually, like, a lot of its remakes of songs from their self-titled debut. But, this is the only album by them I really like. It's hardcore music, but at its most progressive, very just intense, heavy, detailed, complicated riffs, and it's just a lot of fun to listen to. It's a great album to just like flip shit and break everything. So next we have some Dredge albums. Dredge is an interesting band. Their first album is one of my favorites. It's over in my top 50 collection, and then each subsequent release, it's just, like, they're all weird. Every Dredge album is totally different and very weird. This is their third album, Catch Without Arms, which is okay. It's very sort of poppy, and it wasn't really my thing, but it's got some great songs on it. Like, the first two are fantastic, so still worth owning. Their second album, El Cielo, which was a very dreamy sort of experimental release. Have not really listened to this much in a long time, so I'd be interested to know how I feel about it now. Dream Theater's Train of Thought. Dream Theater sucks, and they're a bunch of dicks. They basically suck a bunch of dicks. But this album's okay. This was their heavy album. It was their seventh album, actually, and it's the heaviest of the bunch. I used to like this a lot back when I was getting into prog music in 2006. Don't really care about it that much anymore, and I just hate the band. Because they are assholes. They're really pretentious assholes. Anyway. Scab Dates. This is the Mars Volta's live album. Fun thing about this album is that it's really strange. It's like an hour and 20 minutes of like seven tracks. And it just goes through all kinds of crazy passages and stuff. And so I always thought that Mars Volta performances were just really, really out there. Like, I just thought their live shows was just crazy experimental randomness. Turns out that's not really the case. I still haven't been to one of their shows, mind you, oddly. But I know that their live shows were actually, they would just actually play their songs. The reason that this album is so weird is because the band leader, Omar Rodriguez Lopez, had said that he wanted it to be... He talks about, like, how when he used to watch live DVDs and CDs, they would usually have, like, lots of background information about the tour and stuff and all kinds of, like, dialogue from the people and stuff like that, and he wanted to emulate that on his CD. But his idea of doing so was to just throw all that stuff into the middle of songs while they're happening, because the guy is, he's insane. So his ideas of things are always out there, so this is definitely a perfect example of that. The latest Mars Volta album, Nocturnicate, it's not very good, but I have it, just because, whatever, my mom bought it. And their album, what's it called? The Bedlam and Goliath, which was their fourth album. I think it was probably their most commercially successful album. It's still not very good. All their good albums are in my top 50 collection. Their first three, which I'm a big fan of. The fourth one, it's okay, but I have not been that into it. Blues Funeral by Mark Lanegan. This is his latest release, and it's very strange. It's sort of God, how would you even describe this? Because Mark Lanegan is traditionally mostly a folk, sort of country folk artist in a way. Like, he covers a lot of old country songs in a folk blues style. So for this album, he started to take his folk blues influence and add a lot of industrial and pop flavor to it on this album. So it's really out there. It's the only Mark Lanegan album I own, because my cousin had most of them, but yeah, it's pretty cool. Next we have Isis with Panopticon. Isis, again, power of post-metal band. I think that the genre post-metal first existed on their album Oceanic, which is one of my favorites. It's in the top 50. This is the album right after that, and this is the most definitively post-metal album that they did. Like, Oceanic still had influences from sludge, which was the original genre. By this time, they had fully moved into post-metal, and it's pretty good stuff. If you're interested in post-rock or post-metal, this is an album to check out. Gorillaz' Demon Days. This is a classic. I'm sure we are all familiar with songs from this album. If you've ever heard Feel Good Inc., then there you go. This, you know, when I was, back when this came out, like 2005, this is a big deal for, like, me and my brother. We listened to this album constantly. I know these songs by heart, you know. I'm really burned out on it at this point. Like, a lot of the time I listen to this and it just kind of goes right through me. Like, it's not even like I'm hearing it. It's like as natural to listen to this as it is to, like, drink water, you know, and equally bland, I guess, as drinking water. So, but only at this point. Like, it is a great album. Here's an Opeth collection. I bought this when I first got into the band Opeth. It is four albums. Now, mind you, they have a shitload, and so this is like not, this is like only a dent of their collection, but it's four albums from the middle section of their career. So, like, Blackwater Park, which I think was their fifth album. This is one of the best Opeth albums, and it almost was in my top 50 albums list. The only problem is that Opeth is hard to listen to, because it's really just dark, brutal, grindy music. And if you're not in the mood for that, you can't. You just can't take Blackwater Park and just listen to it all willy-nilly. It takes concentration to listen to this album. So it's kind of a difficult listen. That was followed up by their actually lightest album, Damnation. Because Opeth is known for, they constantly switch between extreme progressive metal, which is just like heavy, dark shit, and then they have light passages, where it's still dark, but it's in like a light, sort of airy guitars, like, it's not acoustic, but it almost sounds acoustic. So, Damnation is all light tracks. It's all songs that were not dark, and, I mean, they're still dark, but they're not just, you know, it's like, instead of, so that's Damnation. Then, Damnation was actually released around the same time as Deliverance, which was meant to be, like, the most dark album. It's, like, mostly dark growls, screams, and stuff like that. Deliverance and Damnation, both of them were pretty okay. Neither one of them is anywhere near my favorite Opeth album. And then Lamentations, which is a live CD from this era. So, there's that as well. I have two more... No... Do I have two more? I have one more Opeth album. I have Ghost Referees over there. I'm meaning to get my hands on Watershed, which belongs in my top 50, but I don't own it yet. And I don't have their first four albums, but my cousin did, and that's how I know their whole discography. Portugal the Man's EP, It's Complicated Being a Wizard. This EP, interestingly enough, I found it at Best Buy, and it was like $8 or so, and it's funny, because it lists like a shitload of tracks. But it's actually just one song, It's Complicated Being a Wizard, and then the EP also has the same, because it's a 20-minute track, and then it has it broken up into individual songs. So it's really just one 20-minute song that's on here twice, weirdly enough. But it's a pretty cool EP. Portugal the Man is sort of their early stuff was really experimental rock songs, and they sort of moved into more and more of a folk direction, which is what they're at now. They're like at a folk sort of rock and roll, almost old school kind of sound. But this was them at their most experimental. This was like they did like a whole electronic song for an EP, and that's what that is. So it's pretty cool. Not the best Portugal the Man thing, but it's neat to own. I've got some more over there in the top 50. Pink Floyd's Dark Side of the Moon. I stole this from my cousin Boyd, and it's pretty cool. I didn't grow up with Pink Floyd, but when I was about 13, I saw The Wall, and I thought it was fantastic. It's one of my mom's favorite movies. She's a big fan of The Wall. And, you know, there's songs from The Wall that I love, but I've never really gotten into it as a full album, and then I had never, like, listened to any other Pink Floyd until Dark Side. And, you know, this album is extremely famous. It's the third best-selling album of all time after, like, or no, second best-selling after Thriller. So this is, you know, it's fucking huge, which is strange because it's such a bizarre album to be a second, you know, best of all time or best-selling. That something so experimental could be so famous, it's weird that other experimental stuff isn't that famous. But it is a great album. I've gotten into it. Yeah, I like it. This is one of the weirdest albums in my collection, Otsuki Kenji to Zetsubou Shoujo Tachi. If you've ever seen the anime series Sayonara Zetsubou Sensei, this is from that. It's a show with a cast of a lot of... It takes place... Like, the main character is a high school teacher who's extremely depressed and he's just constantly trying to kill himself. And his class is full of all these girls who each are defined by a personality disorder. So, like, there's the one girl who has OCD, and that's, like, her whole character is having OCD. And so the Zetsubou girls are all insane, and it's a really fun show. It's a comedy show, and the opening themes are done by this guy named Otsuki Kenji, who does these, like, weird, bizarre rock songs. And the opening themes, they would feature him and then also vocals from each of the voice actresses who play the Zetsubou girls. Well, then they did a whole album of just his music with their vocals on it, and it's fucking weird and cool, and I got that at Otakon a few years ago. Omar Rodriguez Lopez, Se Dice Bisonte No Buffalo. This is the guitarist of the Mars Volta, who is also the band leader, Omar Rodriguez Lopez, puts out albums constantly. This guy puts out 4 albums a year, like, at minimum. And this is just one of his albums that my cousin Boyd had, and I stole it from him. So, it's pretty cool stuff. This is one of his best, in my opinion. It's one of the more accessible of his albums, because they tend to be really weird. So, yeah. And I also have an account, Se Dice Bisonte, that I went by for a while. Mostly when I talked about manga and images and stuff, I would use that name. This is Mogwai's Mr. Beast album. When I was getting into post-rock is when was when this album came out. Obviously, Mogwai is, like, the biggest name in post-rock. I've never gotten that into them, including this album. I bought it, but I've never been, like, a huge fan. I still think it's good, but I've never gotten that into Mogwai. Misfits Famous Monsters, another one I stole from my cousin Boyd. Misfits are best known for their old stuff. Like, their first 3 albums, 3 or 4 albums, when they, like, from the 70s or 80s or whenever, is what they're best known for. I like this album the most out of all of their albums. It's from the 90s, so it's, you know, it's not nearly as popular as their old stuff, but I think it's better. It's just got more catchy, fun songs to it, you know. It's all about horror movies and stuff, and it's just a lot of fun to listen to. Very memorable. Typo Negative's Life is Killing Me album. Fun fact, this is one of my least favorite Typo Negative albums, but I always loved Bloody Kisses, like, when I was a teenager, and I always wanted to buy it, but it was always, like, $22 for some reason. Like, Typo Negative albums were always super expensive, except for this one, because it was, like, their first major label release, I guess. Like, I think it was with Roadrunner or something. Anyway, yeah, Roadrunner. So, it was easier to come by, but it's actually my least favorite Typo Negative album. And I think I only have one other, which is a live one. Anyway, Tool's OP8. This was the first Tool EP. It's pretty cool stuff. It's just like 6 really heavy, grungy songs from their early days. And I like that. Again, the Typo Negative live album, Origin of the Feces. This is weird. It's a fake live album. Typo Negative were given money to go record a live album, and instead they blew all the money on drugs and then recorded a fake live album in the studio. But it's a lot of fun because it's got, like, parts where they get a bomb threat at the performance, and the whole crowd is always going, you suck, and stuff like that. So it's just a weird sort of comedy release. Not that great, but whatever. And then Primordial's To the Nameless Dead. This album, Primordial songs all kind of sound alike. And it's good stuff, but it's, I don't know why, I've never gotten that into them. But the second track on this, Gallows Hymn, is one of my favorite songs of all time. When this came out, it was, the metal community really embraced it. It's definitely a band that's popular among metal fans, but I don't know why, I've just never quite gotten into Primordial. And finally, capping off this overly long section, we have this stack of CDs that I have down here. These CDs fall into one of 3 categories, because, obviously this was stacked full, so These are either CDs that A, the disc was missing, B, I don't really like the CD anymore, so I kind of just said, this one can go out of the collection, or C, it's just not mine. So we have the first Disturbed album, which I still stand by that this is a pretty decent album. Disturbed went completely up their own ass after this album, but I don't have the disc in here, so that's why it's in the bottom section. Guar, this is America Must Be Destroyed. I don't think the disc is in here, and this isn't mine, it's Boyd's. Yeah, the disc is not in here. America Must Be Destroyed is my favorite Guar album. It's just hilarious, crazy, violent music. They just played, like, metal, and it was... On this album, they were really creative and fun songs. They later... A lot of their stuff is just, like, sort of generic metal music, but it's a... If you don't know about Guar, just go look them up. Go look up some videos of Guar, and you'll quickly get what makes them special. But, yeah, they're worth knowing about. The fourth Coheed and Cambria... Third Coheed and Cambria album, In Keeping Secrets of Silent Earth 4, Volume 1. The discs is not in here, that's why it's in the bottom section, but I have the two-disc collector set, which comes with a DVD. This is, it's far from my favorite Coheed album, but it is a great album. It has Welcome Home, which is probably their best-known song on it, so it's pretty cool. This is actually, I think, the first Misfits album, one of the earliest Misfits albums, not mine. Don't even know why it's up here, actually, and there's no disc in it, so that's not helpful. The Eminem Show. I was just going through my family collection, like, because my mom has a giant collection of CDs in her study, and I saw this, and I was like, oh, I need the Eminem Show, because I don't have the whole album on my computer or anything, and then the disc is not in here, sadly, so I still don't have the Eminem Show. The Mono album, You Are There. Mono play, they're like the post-rock band. They're like the epitome of what post-rock is. A Japanese post-rock band that is very popular. This is a pretty good album. I've never been that into Mono, but it's pretty cool. There's no disc in here, again. And I stole that from Boyd as well. He let me. An early Dream Theater album, Awake. I have been meaning to try this again, because it might be okay, but again, I'm just not into Dream Theater. I don't remember when I bought this, but I remember I was never very into it. AFI's Sing the Sorrow, actually apparently signed by the band. My mom found this in a car, like, that we rent, like, some random car she found this in, and it's pretty good. It's got some decent tracks on it, like, you know... What's that one? Girls Not Grey and stuff, so... Feel Good Hit of the Summer by Queens of Stone Age. I've still never listened to this. It just kind of ended up in my room somehow from Boyd. It's got the disc in it and everything. I just haven't listened to it. That's why it's not in my collection proper. Oh, Skeleton Witch. Another one that just kind of fell out of Boyd's collection into mine. This is a blackened thrash metal band I'm not really into, but whatever. Rise Against the Sufferer and the Witness. I think my mom bought this, and it's decent. It's just like a punk rock album. It's pretty okay. And finally, Avenged Sevenfold City of Evil. I used to be a big fan of this album back in the... around when it came out, for years. And all the other Avenged Sevenfold albums suck balls. Their first two albums are horrible. The albums after this are just atrocious. Some of the worst albums I've ever heard, literally. But City of Evil was pretty okay, but these days I'm just not that into it anymore. So, that covers my entire CDs and DVDs collection, with the exception of my favorite CDs that we'll get to later. This was probably the longest video yet. I think it was about an hour, so hopefully that makes up for the lack of videos. And next we'll be moving on to my manga collection in the next video.